I dream about surfing, and I really think about a lot of surfboards. The surfboards I should have made, like right now I think about boards that should be about 6.5 or 7 feet long and about 5 inches thick. That's what we should be riding. We should have been riding those 50 years ago. But so those things you think about and you play around with it. And I was sort of thinking in those terms when I quit surfing, but when you once quit, surfboards are messy to build. You just can't do it. During the war, the beach, there was nobody on the beaches. People were had two jobs, and there was gas rationing. And the day that we took that board down there, there was absolutely nobody at Seal Beach. A couple of people on the pier, but there was my buddy Joe Denny and I, and that's all there were. And some of the beaches had barbed wire on them and everything else. We lived in Cyprus, but Sundays I could hitchhike to Huntington Beach after I was about 15, and I'd hitchhike down to Highway 39 and then down to Huntington, and I had a billy board and swim fins. Swim fins came out at 39, and I bought a pair, cost $6, the old Churchills, and I'd go down and ride my billy board in Huntington. They were about 3/8 plywood, and they were sort of small, no fin or anything. We just, you could go into Huntington Beach lumber yard, and they cut them out, and they were 35 cents, and you'd take them home and varnish them. Swim fins opened the whole body surfing billy board world up, you know. But there were quite a few surfers there. There were probably there'd be as many as 6 or 8 guys out there. And the star of the bunch was a guy named Hot Rod Dunn. He was really good. He'd shoot through that pier with a 100-pound board, and I thought that was absolutely fantastic, you know, to be able to do that. But those guys were actually pretty darn good, you know. They'd take off on those damn things, and a lot of them didn't have fins on them, and shoot the pier, and every once in a while one would get broken on wooden boards, but most of them actually were also reinforced with rubber. Most of them had a pretty good V bottom on them. But that's been out on you, you know. I mean, they could lose them really easy. But most guys, sooner or later, put on a small fin, you know, shaped like that. Pretty long, about 4 inches deep. I started when I was 15. I was about 1942. But there were hardly any surfers around, and there were some older guys at Huntington Pier, you know, they were guys that were going in the Army, and a Japanese kid made a paddleboard, about a 9-foot paddleboard in high school wood shop, and they took him off to internment camp, and I bought his paddleboard. I paid the wood bill on his paddleboard, and that was the first surfboard I had. His name was Sugio Saito, S-A-I-T-O. Never saw or heard of him again. It rode pretty darn good. You'd catch any wave with it, because I was only 15. But the first day we took it to Seal Beach, my buddy and I, who had grown a car, we both got rides and rode it in, didn't fall off. But we didn't know that you were supposed to go down the line with it either, you know. Didn't have a fin on it. I only surfed that paddleboard a couple of times before I went in the Navy. When I went in the Navy, my paddleboard disappeared. When I came home 2 years later, it wasn't anywhere around.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
My dad and I were taking a heifer up to another ranch in Brea, and we took the heifer up there, and the guy said, you know, the Japanese bombed somewhere called Pearl Harbor. And my dad said they did. He said, where's Pearl Harbor? He said, the other guy said, I don't know. But I remember that day. I went in the Navy in 44. Well, I went in late in the war, and the war was basically, well, the war was over in 45. Well, I wanted to be a pilot, but it was too late, and the pilot program was called V-5, but they had another program called Combat Aircrew, CAC program, and you had to get into that program before you enlisted. They give you a lot of tests and all that, and it was aerial gunnery. So I passed all the tests, and I got in, went in to go to aerial gunnery school and bombardier school. I went got on a train in L.A. with a bunch of other guys, and we went to Jacksonville, Florida. And that's where it all started. I went to boot camp there, and then we went to aviation ordnance school in Norman, Oklahoma. And I went to Yellowwater, Florida, to Air Gunner School, and I went back to Jacksonville Bombardier School, and we started flying in the PBYs. And the PBYs were all junk by the time we got done with them, and then I flew in the SB-2C dive bombers for a while, and finally they eliminated that program. Everything was getting cut off as we went along, until finally, you know, they just started discharging people, and it was all over. I'll tell you, the Navy was the best thing that ever happened to me. I got into boxing. I got into lifting weights, which I always wanted to do. I always wanted to box, and I always wanted to lift weights, since I was a teenager. And I got to do it, and I really liked the Navy. Met a lot of good guys, and came out of there a lot better person, I think. That seems like 100 years ago. You know, well, the whole deal was my grandmother's sisters, she married a guy that had some money, and they owned a couple of hotels, one in San Pedro and one in Long Beach. And when we came out here, my Aunt Henrietta went worked for her in the San Pedro Hotel, and she met this guy who was a sea captain. He was a Norwegian guy, and they got married. And his name was Harry Bartley. But Harry Bartley was fascinated with guys riding surfboards. He used to go down to Palos Verdes and watch them. And I would stay with them sometime, and they didn't have any children, so I'd stay with them maybe for a week in the summertime. And my Uncle Harry would take me down to Palos Verdes and watch the guys ride the waves in. So he was so enthusiastic about it and sort of mystified about how they did it. And he was older then. He was, I don't know how old he was, but he was older than any of the surfers were. And I think that got me started, that started the bug of the surf thing. One thing that I really liked about the ocean that it was clean. And Huntington Beach was, you know, the water down there, you could see the bottom at the end of the pier when we were surfing down there. And, you know, where we lived, everything was dusty. Everything, you know, when the Santa Ana would blow in the old days, your house was full of sand, was dirt. If you didn't get the windows closed, everything was had a layer of dust on it. And I really liked the cleanliness of that down there. The sand was clean, the water was clean, everything was great. You know, I could swim when I was a kid, 3 or 4 years old. Folks would take me to Colorado Lagoon and in Long Beach, and I'd just jump in the water and swim like I knew how. So I was never afraid of the water. The water was like my friend. Mary and Adolf, Mary Margaret and Adolf Henry. Oh, they're just great. They're great parents, but they never really pulled out of the Depression. He was the same size as I used to be. He was 6'2" and pretty muscular, strong guy, and very pleasant, very friendly with people, and. Honest as the day is long. He was absolutely, would never do anything, cheat anybody or take advantage of people. I was born in 27 and 29, the Depression hit. And my grandfather had a produce business in Trinidad, Colorado. And my uncle, you know, my father's brother, was in the produce, part of the produce thing, and they had an ammonia leak, and he inhaled a lot of ammonia and was ill, and the doctor says bring him to California, so everybody moved out here. I was 2 years old. I came out here right in the middle of the Depression. No jobs, nothing happening, and it was a tough going, and I think they always acted like they had a better life in Colorado, but, you know, my dad worked in this ranch, managed a ranch for a guy in Cyprus, and he stayed with the guy, and he should have probably, when the war came, got into the war industry, you know, and building something, because he was a good manager, and, but he didn't, and but they lived in Long Beach, and they did okay. My parents really never had much of a life. They never went on vacations. They didn't do anything. They just worked and slaved away. I think the things I got from my dad was learn how to fix everything and be honest and loyal to your friends. I guess that's what I got from him, and those were good things. He let me do pretty much what I wanted to. I mean, there wasn't like absolute freedom, but he He didn't particularly try to send me in any direction. You know, he sort of let me do what I wanted. Well, you know, there were more surfers than surfboards, and you knew the surfboard. You know the surfboard. Two or three guys would go surfing with one surfboard. Took turns riding them, you know, because of the shortage of boards. But data in numbers, I have no idea. There was probably 25 guys in San Diego and 25 guys in San Onofre and 25 guys at Malibu and 25 guys at Donington. Yeah, a crowd a day out there would be like 10 guys maybe.
One, two, three, four.
Well, you know, like I tell guys, certain events of surfing happened, and I always say, well, we didn't know we were making history, you know, but we really were. But we absolutely thought nothing of that part of it. We just thought that's the way it was always going to be, and we certainly never thought that there'd be over. 1,000 surfers in the world, you know, and but technology did it. The foam and the fiberglass and the guys that put it all together gave us some darn good things to ride. I started going to Huntington with another belly board, and I still had the old fins, and I met a guy in Huntington Beach named Rocky Freeman, who lives there, and he just got out of the Navy. He and I became pals, and we started making surfboards out of balsa wood life rafts that they had during the war. They had these they were a balsa wood ring that was probably about 6 by 10 maybe, and the balsa wood part was maybe 18 inches square that went around the ring to support, to float the grate that was the middle. And those were life rafts on a lot of different merchant ships. So we'd strip the canvas off of the balsa wood and put the pieces together, you know. There's a lot of putty in there that the guys that build them got away with. But we started making balsa wood surfboards and started surfing again. But there were a couple of places that made them. One was called the old Swastika board. And then there's a ladder company that made a few boards. But basically, you had to make one. And a lot of guys made paddle boards because they were easy to make. And then a lot of guys made the build-up boards. They had the hollow center like a paddle board, and they had the wooden rails. But one day, Matt Kivlin came down to San Onofre, and he had this board that is... they were the predecessor to this trestle special that Phil and Hobie were making. But anyway, except for a rocker, that board was pretty much like they are today, really. The San Onofre guys, and history sort of bears me out, they didn't want to change. They wanted those boards, those old boards where you took off and you went pretty much towards shore, and try to look sort of graceful while you're doing it. But when we start bringing solid balsa wood boards down there and the foam boards and stuff, they didn't like that at all. They thought that was terrible. We're ruining a whole traditional thing. But I was one of the old guys down there too, but it was, it seemed to me like the boards were way too heavy and that turned out to be right also. But the Malibu guys were really the guys that were doing the most with the surfboards. Matt Kivlin and Dave Rockland and Joe Quigg. They were into the balsa wood boards early, and they started getting better shapes on them, and I copied Matt Cousins for it, and then the rocker really didn't come until the foam thing. Yeah, we talk about them endlessly, and nobody really knew what the heck was going on, and we all started experimenting, you know, and it reached a pretty common shape. You know, boards are pretty much all alive now. And then the foam came along in 58, and that's about where we are now, really. We were all competitive swimmers. Everybody I knew that was a surfer in those days, swam competitively in school someplace. Well, I'll tell you, when I started surfing, you'd take your surfboard, your belly board, your swim fins, a football, and an abalone iron. That was in the car. And surfing, standing up on the surfboard wasn't a full attraction. It was, if it was a low tide, and we'd go body surfing or something, you know, or ride our belly boards. Or if it was real low tide, we'd go down to Abalone Point and go abalone diving. And everybody could swim. Everybody was a good swimmer. Phil Edwards was the first really good surfer that told me he couldn't body surf. He learned to body surf after he could surf. Well, I remember in Huntington at low tide, we used to have these walking contests. See who could walk the fastest? You know, that was one of the things we did, which is absolutely absurd now, but that's one of the things we did. There's a kid down there I used to take to Malibu with, named Blackie Oppenauer, and he could walk so damn fast that we'd have to run to keep up with him. You know, which is irrelevant, but just one of the things that happened. Yeah, I went to college, and I got out, went to college. I went to Cal Poly in San Luis Obispo the first year, and I've been gone for 2 years, and then I went to school. I was gone another year. My mom was complaining she didn't know me anymore, so I went to Whittier College. I graduated from there. I got a teaching credential, but I sort of blew college. I wish I'd have. I wanted summers off then because I'd gotten into the surfing more, and a lot of surfers were school teachers, so I sort of followed along with them. But I wish I'd have taken something a little tougher, you know. Well, you know. When I got out of the Navy, I was a pretty damn good boxer, and I understood the manly art of self-defense. And if some bully who's really tough wants to beat on you, he can beat on you, but he's not going to hurt you very bad, you know. You can block his blows and everything. And I hated bullies. A lot of the trouble I got into was bullies, making bullies, backing bullies down or making them leave guys alone, you know. But we all want to be Hawaiians. All the San Onofre guys played ukuleles and they sang Hawaiian songs and we wore Hawaiian trunks and we all wanted to be Hawaiian or go to Hawaii. You know, that was Mecca. That was getting to the motherland of us guys. It's got the waves and it's got, it's got the pipeline. It's got all the stuff that everybody wants to do. I went to Hawaii in 1952 and I was 25. And I spent almost the whole year there. I got a job at the Moana Hotel, and I either worked from 7 in the morning till 3 in the afternoon, or 3 in the afternoon till 10 at night, and I served every day. But it was great. It wasn't real crowded, and the only trouble was we didn't have good boards. We were still with wooden boards and all balsa boards. few paddle boards were out there. I took a redwood balsa board there, and I rode it most of the time. And then I bought a solid balsa glass board from another Howley that was leaving, and I rode that most of the rest of the time. The guys had hot curl boards there, and they were a devil to ride. There are a few guys over there that were really, really good. Blackout Whaley and Rabbit Cake High, and Matt Kivlin made an all balsa hot curl board. Matt would go back and forth, and he sold it to a Hawaiian kid that I know, and he would let me use it. And I finally got so I could ride that thing fairly well, but nothing like the hot guys could, nothing like the Ed Whaley was the master of it. You know, they'd get in a curl and just fly with us. And they had a deep V in the tail, and the tail was like that, and the deck was rounded off. And, you know, most of those Hawaiian guys rode those big boards with no fins on them. And the trick was to keep them from spinning out, keep them from sliding down the wave. But those guys would, you'd get the thing in the wave, and then you'd sort of let the outside deck down a little bit so that V would catch in the wave. And you could turn them by actually spinning them out and catching the spinner. But they were tricky as heck. You'd be flying along thinking you're really doing good, and the next thing you're going backwards. you've lost it. There was never a time over there where I felt any animosity much or anything. It depended on how you treated them. If you gave them a right away and had good surf etiquette, you didn't have any trouble at all. Well, the Hawaiian guys had nowhere to go, and there were so darn many white guys going over there. Most of the Howleys didn't stay though; they'd go over there for a while and then go home. But it was easy to see why they had trouble, you know. And a lot of the Howley guys were Arab, and they were, you get three or four of them together, and they thought they were tough and everything. They could get in a lot of trouble. But I never had any trouble over there at all. But an incident happened over there. When I was there, the Korean War was happening, and there were three Keikai brothers. Rabbit Keikai was the most well known. He died at age 96, and he was probably the best surfer. And then there was Jama, J-A-M-A Keikai, who was a big canoe paddle guy. And then there was a guy named Samson Keikai, who wasn't a real brother, but the family took him in. He was an orphan. But anyway, during the Korean War, there was a rotating bar out on the sand at Waikiki Beach that made a revolution every 30 minutes. It was between Wana Hotel and a surf ride hotel. And I walked in there one night, and Samson Keikai was sitting across the circular bar from me. And he's having a beer, and I had a beer. And where I sat down, there were four Army guys behind me that were really drunk. And when Samson would go around, they'd call him a nigger, and, hey, we don't serve niggers in here, and what are you doing in here, and stuff. And the thing would make a revolution in about 20 minutes or a half hour. So after another revolution, I went over and sat down by Samson. He says, I don't need any help from you. I said, yeah, but I might defuse it. I said, those guys are getting drunk. You don't know what the heck they're running there. So anyway, the next time around the table, I talked to one of them that wasn't so bad. The strange thing with these guys, they had these uniforms with all this gold braid and stuff on them, you know, like, I don't know what part of the army they were in, but anyway, they left, the army guys left, Samson left and I left, and about a week later, I'm walking down Calicala Avenue, and they have access to the beach. There'll be buildings that are 3 or 4 feet apart about every block or so, and you can walk down to the beach that way, so everybody has access. So I'm walking by this access to the beach, and this guy grabs me and jerks me in the access. He says, hey, howdy, boy, I want you to meet my friends. And it was Samson. But anyway, there was another group of guys down there. They called them the Reef Gang. And they had what looked like an old tugboat, and they surfed that reef from Diamond Head up to Honolulu Harbor, you know, that one big reef that had a lot of surf breaks. And they were nobody wanted anything to do with them. They were the baddest, toughest guys. They wore knives on their calves, and they got half their teeth were missing, and some of them had their hair bleached partly and stuff. So Samson takes me back. He says, I want you to meet some of my friends. We go back there, and everybody drank, all the Hawaiians drank Primo beer. And they had a case of cold Primo beer, and it was the Reef Gang. I thought, oh, crap, somebody would kill. But anyway, he says, hey, this Howley guy helped me out. Looked out for him. And I shook hands with all of them, and I'm all smiles. And I sat down there and had a beer with them, and I never had any trouble with anybody. Well, you know, 50, 60 years ago, people looked out for each other, and there weren't many lawsuits, there weren't many police around, and my dad would never walk away from a bad situation like that. You know, he'd help a person or talk somebody out of causing trouble, and. But, you know, things are so different now. There's so many factions out there that cause trouble and all that. Well, as I said earlier, in the real old days, I'm talking about around the 40s, a guy named Chester Dunn was everybody's opinion, the best surfer at Huntington Beach. They called him Hot Rod Dunn. Well, he went into the Air Force and became a pilot during World War II, and nobody ever heard of him after that. So I was in Hawaii in Waikiki in 1952, and I never went back until 1962. And I spent 2 months over there. I got time off from work, and I had a nice surfing vacation. And I had my surfboard in the surfboard racks that you can rent there at Waikiki Beach. I took my surfboard out of the rack one day, and I went down, and I was just about to step on the sand. I'm still on the concrete part. And there was a man in an army uniform standing there with wings on a uniform. And he said hello to me, and I said, hi. And he says, you're going surfing? I said, yeah, I just have my board in here in the rental. I said, are you a surfer? He said, well, I used to surf at Huntington Beach before the war. And I said, what's your name? He said, Chester Dunn. I said, you're Hot Rod Dunn? I said, you've been one of my idols all of my surfing life. I remember you shooting the pier with those big, awkward 100-pound boards with no fins on them. He says, I'll be darned. He said, I never thought anyone would ever remember me. But the guy had been all through the war, had been in China and everywhere else in World War II. He looked much older than his years, and he looked like he had been worked hard. So that was the Hot Rod Dunn story. Well, you know, the good-for-nothing thing didn't come along until the drugs did, which was, in my opinion, you know, quite a bit later, because it was after the war when kids would drop out of school to surf and, you know, and they were into marijuana and all that stuff. I was a captain on a fire department for 20 years, and my guys sometimes complained that I wasn't so soft-spoken, but somehow or other we got the job done, I guess. Well, you know, it all gets down to knowing your job and knowing what to do at a special instance. And I was lucky in that I worked in a real busy station for about the first 7 years I worked there. We had a lot of runs and we had a lot of fire. You know, 60 years ago or so when I went on the fire department, we had a lot more fires than they do now. I mean building fires, house fires. More people were smoking. We didn't have smoke detectors. The building codes are more strict and they're more enforced. But the fire department has gone to the medical department almost, you know. Most of their runs are medical runs now. We had every other day off, and darn right, that was I jumped on that opportunity to take the fire department's test, and I loved it. I loved doing it. I liked going to work every day, and it was a great part of my life.
And you were still surfing Huntington Beach at that point, mostly?
Huntington and Malibu and Salt Creek. We surfed there a lot. And Trestle and San Onofre. I was one of the original members of the San Onofre Surf Club. But, you know, I'd surfed there since 1946. Oh, I remember the one about the Marines shooting at us out there, and we were at the Trestle. And the guy that was out there with me, the guy that was the coach at SC, he said, "Let's go in." So we paddled in, and he went up to those Marines, and I don't know what he told them, and he had those guys lined up, marched up with their guns at parade rest, and just gave them hell. And he just had his trunks on. But they knew that the guy knew what he was talking about. And but anyway, the story of being shot at, I don't know how many times it happened, but it definitely happened the day I was out there. You know, in the old days, take San Onofre, the boards would come all the way in. You know, now you lose your board, and they're light enough to sort of get out of the wave somehow, and the big fins will get him out. But the boards, like the redwood board up on the wall there, you could fall off it, and it would just stay right in the wave and go along. Yeah, I had a buddy that lived in Santa Cruz. He'd call me when Steamer Lane was coming up, and if I could get up there for a couple of days, I'd go up and see him, and we'd surf Steamer Lane. And Wild Hook, that place that they say I named was down there by Pleasure Point. Yeah, I have a small fin. It had kelp. Would go, you know, from the bottom up, and then would go along the surface. And it was so damn thick. If you had a long fin, you couldn't make it to the kelp there. It'd just stop you dead. But it was a nice little hot ride there. Now you swim the course at Steamer Lane, and you'd have a ice cream headache, and you'd be in trouble. It'd be so damn cold. Oh, the water's like 52 and 50, and just colder than hell. Well, Well, the etiquette thing, it's my wave thing, really came along with the surf contest. Before that, I think probably either Mike Made Right or you sort of knew who you were surfing with and who was going to cause the trouble and all that. But I think the surf contest brought that it's my wave and all the trouble. I mean, that's just my own personal. I went up to Malibu one day, and I went surfing. I'm paddling out, and this really nice little, about a 3-foot wave came, and I spun around and took off on it. And there was a guy behind me about 20 feet, and I saw him, but I didn't figure I'd interfere with him or anything. So I took off down the beach, and then pretty soon I saw that guy. I knew him, and his name was Rydell. He was, he wanted to be Matt Kivlin. He did everything Matt Kivlin did. Anyway, I saw him walk up and down the beach, sort of agitated, and I saw, there was a great guy named Buzzy Trent, a big wave rider. He was the guy that rode the first 35-foot wave at Waimea, they say. Anyway, I saw Buzzy talking to him. So I thought, Jesus, I better go in there and see what's going on. So I went in, and Rydell was pissed off. He was waiting for me to come in. He was going to beat me up. So Buzzy talked to him for a while, and he changed his mind about beating me up. But I went in and apologized to him. And then he and I became good friends. About 1958, the foam came out, and the surfing industry really exploded. And the surfers, you know, the boards were light, easy to ride, anybody could surf. And the thing really got going. And a thing sprung up called the United States Surfing Association, USSA. They were trying to promote surfing. And I remember I went to a meeting at the Huntington Beach lifeguard quarters, and it was surf industry guys trying to promote surf contests at Huntington Pier, because it's a nice arena. You know, the spectators can be on the pier, and it's got good waves and everything. And I said, hey, you guys all live here, you all surf here. What do you think is going to happen if you start having a contest there? Well, it's going to be good for everybody. And they were trying to promote their businesses and so forth. And there weren't very many surfers in those days compared to now. You know, surfing like doubled every year there for a few years. But when they started getting a surf down there, all the local guys got pushed out almost. You had to fight for a wave and I interfered. I got married on my 40th birthday to an Australia lady named Jennifer Davies. And we were married 10 years and she passed away. Gee, I don't know, there's so many good surfers out there now, we rode the heavy boards. It was pretty easy because you didn't have to do much, what can you do with the damn thing? You just sort of stand there and the board does what it wants to do. I think Ed Whaley, he was a Hawaiian and he was, he'd get tan and he was really dark. They call him Blackout, but he could, he really looked good on a surfboard, did all kinds of great things with a hot curl board. And I always admired Phil Edwards because he was such a gentleman and such a such a smooth, stylistic surfer. L.J. Richards was, he was one hell of a surfer, that guy. He was really good. He won the Huntington contest and everything else. Plus, he was a neat guy. He was like Phil, same kind of personality. But I'll tell you, the best surfer that I was ever around and got to surf with a lot was Timmy Dorsey from Seal Beach. Nobody can do what that guy can do on a surfboard and look as good as he does it. And I don't care who you drive out there. Gordy was making surfboards, and he was coming down to Huntington Beach, but the Huntington Beach guys didn't really accept him. And he sort of befriended me, and I got him in with the group, and then we started shaping boards, and he opened a surf shop down there, and we got a partnership going, and and we were palling around, and Gordy was married and had a little daughter, and when the thing really started going, there were a lot of young gals started hanging around the surf shop, and Gordy was thinking about leaving his wife, and one day his wife called me and told me that Gordy beat me up last night, and I said, well, gee, that's terrible. So I talked to Gordy, and he told me it was none of my business. Long story short, Gordy and I got into it and dissolved the partnership, and I dissolved Gordy for a while. But Jerry does everything for me, takes care of me and leads me around, and I don't know what I'd do if Jerry wasn't here. I'd be... Well, we've had a darn good relationship. We've been together almost 25 years, haven't we, Jerry?
Yeah.
I was surfing down in Boca Chica, and I met Jerry down there. There was quite a good bunch of guys down there. For, you know, not being a special place of any kind, there was a decent waves, and you can usually find a open spot someplace. Didn't I give you a ride home when you locked your keys in your car?
That was at Boca Chica, yes. You did do that.
Hey, Jerry and I were in Macaha about, it could have been 10 years ago, huh, Jerry?
Yeah.
We're out of Macaha, and the waves are getting bigger and bigger. We get there, and it's about 4 feet, and then it looks, then it's 6 feet, and then it's 8 feet, and then it's 10 feet. And I look out there, and Jerry's taking off on this. It was a good 10-foot wave, and she gets pitched out. She's knee paddling, she's still knee paddling, flying through the air like this, and crash. So I'd been at Macaha when It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and you better either decide if you're going to ride some big waves or go in. And I stayed out there one day and got terrible wipeouts out there, and I never ever got out. But anyway, I got my boogie board and fins, and I paddled out there to tell her to come in. And while I'm paddling out there, she had a hell of a ride, and then I couldn't get to her in time, and then she gets out there again. So Jerry is taking off on this wave, and I'm taking off on it too because I want to get in. I want to get the hell out of there because boogie boards don't go very fast. So I think Jerry and I were in the same wave, and it closed out between us, but I got the barrel end of it, and this damn barrel of it, Christ, I hope that roof doesn't come down. But you were riding some big waves that day, Jerry. Regrets. Well, yeah, I wish I would have told my parents I loved them more and tell them how much I appreciated what they did for me. But But I don't think I did. But I wish I would have. And well, I changed the college situation around. I really take advantage of what the GI Bill was. That's one thing I would do. And I wouldn't have been a lifeguard. I think that started my eyes down the drain, because you looked into the sun, and we didn't have good sunglasses in those days. And I wouldn't have done that. But I'd have done the surf stuff. I'd probably made more surfboards myself. But I don't know. But you're right about being lucky. Yeah, you have to be lucky to get this far. Or maybe unlucky. I don't know. When I get up in the morning, I wonder, why am I still here? Hey, I tell you, life is just a blur. There's always something that I had to do. I'll tell you what, I was either surfing, water skiing, or snow skiing, or playing volleyball, or playing handball.
Or sailing.
I sailed a lot. I raced on some really good sailboats. Gee, I don't know. You know, it always seemed like we were busy. I was always busy. I always had to be at the next thing I was supposed to be at or something, you know? Like, I just rushed through it all. 90 years of rushing. I don't know. Darn right. Yeah.